We do have the draft underway as Mowgli hovers, waiting. He'll have a Lindis out to his name. That's continuing a 100% ban rate for the character.
Yeah, Europe certainly doesn't like the Lindis, and you can see why last game, and a little bit at least, because even with a slightly neutered version of Lindis and Morin, they were still able to pull that off. Lindis, very similar to Morin in that the late game is terrifying, but Lindis' early game is a lot better.
The Annette will come through as well. Richter to join him. Standard bans so far. The Annette is something existence-focused. Perhaps after Chikatin was so successful, they don't want to give it over to Qlash.
Right, you see that quite a lot, actually. When you're so successful on a hero, they value that shows that they value that hero very highly until they ban it up from the other team.
It could be a first pick. It has been a first pick. It was a first pick. There's no reason to let existence lock it in. Instead, it'll be standard bans across the board. These, if you looked at the chart of things that were super powerful and were banned out, it's these ones.
Yeah, those are the ones at the top of some sort of tier list that I've, you know, maybe.
That's not getting any more mentions now. That's it. It's done now.
Qlash do get.
He made me do it.
Qlash do get picked up over on the Telenas. That's exactly what they want.
It's my former favorite hero, TJ.
Yeah, why are you so pleased to see that? Why is that important for them right now?
Well, this is an old strategy.
Yeah.
With the Qresh and Jinnar, the death ball, essentially.
Uh-huh.
Going with the Metamorphosis, going with the Exuberance, kill everyone in sight.
And it should be noted, old existence, Season 2 existence, executed the death ball. They were one of the best teams at it. Now they should be looking for a Chognar, maybe a Pura, to back it up so they can have these close-range, tight-rank characters that just accelerate into a fight together, and that gets them past many a squishy frontline, which is why Qlash have gone the opposite direction. They draft Amina instantly. Now they go for the mobility of Liliana and Zil, with Roxy to tank up as well, Telenas taking the back line.
I love this from Qlash. They see the death ball coming out and they say, we're going to have some beefy frontliners. Good luck trying to bowl us over.
We're going to play basketball with your death ball.
Something like that. TJ, I want to know what you think about the Joker, because he typically isn't seen in this death ball.
He is the odd one out, but he does give them a sideline answer, I feel, to the Telenas.
Right.
And that's what he's been drafted for, because the Telenas will presumably be run again by Sky, and once it's run in that side lane, you're going to start to see him farm up, get very, very powerful, and you need someone to just be contributing, clearing lane against him, poking away. The range on the Joker rockets make him one of the few characters, and we've seen it a few times, that can actually play lane into a Telenas and find value.
Right.
Mina and Roxy, you don't feel like they're a little bit too similar? Liliana and Zil, they're not sort of duplicating up on mages?
Well, the advantage of Mina and Roxy is they're both good against the dive, because you have the Dark Dominion that taunts everyone who jumps in, and you have the Wildfire, which stays on the ground and is spread on the ground, meaning that as the fight goes on and all these close-range melee characters are bowled up on top of you, you can burn it down.
You enjoyed that just a little bit too much.
That's a little bit too excited about
the burning. Slightly scared, standing next to him for the rest of the evening and tomorrow. Right, so Qlash Spain, 1-0 up over existence. We go to the Antares battlefield, and let's see very shortly. That game's just about upon us. You look pretty happy then with the rosters. They're making sense.
I'm happy to see a return of the Death Ball from existence. It may not work,
yeah,
but I'm happy to see it back because it was one of my favorite parts of Season 2.
Explain just quickly before we go into game, the Death Ball.
Yeah, during Season 2, existence and Dead Rammet, it came out of the Spanish scene, which checks out for this match. And they would play these very tanky compositions revolving typically around Pura and Jinnar and just accelerate into the enemy team, relying on the AoE damage and stun that those characters offer to overwhelm the then-popular Fortress composition.
Right. And because they're all clumped together, you get in there with the Exuberance, you basically take everyone out. They can't really stop the Jinnar from going in, but they do have the Dark Dominion to help with that now, and Roxy, who's going to be a pain in the neck.
And that worked really well against some of the more popular compositions that season, because the Fortress eventually kind of emerged, though it was initially what it was played into. I think the Fortress eventually kind of countered it, because the big Death Ball would get stalled up on the front lines, not be able to get to the back line. But the strongest teams that season were Nova, who were playing these lightweight character drafts that could be overwhelmed.
So existence have got a Death Ball ready, and Qlash are looking to get a 2-0.
Before we get into this, I want to talk lastly about Zil, the hero we didn't go over, and he's going to be a pain in the neck for both Crickneck and Joker in that backline.
And we'll have to see how well it does in jungle, because Redemption is picking up a character here that we haven't seen a ton of this season.
Right. The Zil we've seen a little bit in North America. He is one of the faster junglers in the game as far as the first wave player is concerned. But once he gets in there, he is one of the only legitimate mage junglers, which causes problems because...
What are you saying about Gilder?
I'm sorry. Well, can't really jungle, though.
Yeah, and his role as a mage jungler does cause problems for defending teams because it is a different type of damage.
Right, and it's a little bit of a soft counter to the Joker, because the Joker uses pick a card, any card, to eliminate physical damage. That makes him really good against physical damage dealing assassins, but not magic damage dealing assassins, so he could get torn apart by a tornado, TJ.
Yeah, and the tornado of Redemption is headed the way Gilder was on my mind, like it always is.
My caster skill was on my mind.
I was
ever just, since that day.
I was just focused on Gilder.
Okay.
Chikatin, Royds, and Klamers are all grouped out towards the bot lane, and we didn't even really talk about it, but Klamers is also picking an out-of-meta jungler, though certainly a powerful one.
I think that people have given up a little bit too quickly on the Crick Knight. He's played in Thailand by First One, one of the better assassin junglers in the game. So I think that Crick Knight is perfectly fine. They probably went for him to make sure they have extra insurance for that Telenos.
Yeah, a little bit extra of burst dive. He's one of the highest mobility assassins in the game.
Well, both teams kind of congregating here around that Abyssal Dragon here, TJ.
Yeah, both concerned about picking it up first, and x6tence will look to build out the early lead they enjoyed last game. They've got x6tence to zone on that, and they'll scare back mostly ensuring that that first Abyssal Dragon goes over.
This is a good response here from Qlash when the opposing team goes for the Abyssal Dragon. Instead of just rushing over and panicking and trying to contest hit and losing your entire team, what you can just do is steal the jungle.
Yeah, and Random does exactly that, walking away from the jungle, and he is running a Leviathan build, which isn't something we've seen a ton of in the sideline.
Right, Roxy loves to go for the jungle item. It's a little bit harder to pick up 30 stacks of that these days, but still you can pick up a few here and there.
It used to be the jungle item only required 15 stacks in order to reach maximum. You had to kill 15 jungle monsters in order to get the maximum benefit. Now it takes 30, like you were saying. That's a bigger investment, and one that's harder to get from the sideline.
Which is why she's already investing going into the opposing jungle. If she gets around 20, it'll be pretty much worth it, about the same as the last patch.
Ooh, Agni's Grasp does go wide. Qlash group up down toward the bottom side. That's why x6tence are here in answer. Perhaps looking for some poke.
Well, they're not going to get it, it seems like. Blue Triton, I want to point out, he's already building into that magic defense. Very smart. Sometimes we see players go on autopilot and just, you know, build whatever armor they have. But he is being conscientious about it, making sure that he is going against this Roxy properly.
And they will do exactly that. Random's caught out. There's the death ball. Everything you could need for a close-range AoE punish. You have the Metamorphosis followed by the Exuberance with a drone drop in the middle. On the opposite side of the map, x6tence dueling as well. He'll spend his Chaos Protection to stay invulnerable to Mowgli's Taunt and rely on Royds to do the damage. They narrowly win out. Don't lose any ground at the very least.
Right. Had Sky had a little bit of mana, though, probably would have helped kill out one of those heroes there, either the Joker or the Chognar. So going to be paying attention to that. Is Joker a little bit of trouble now again?
We'll need to play back. Zephyr's joined him in the lane. Mowgli's recalling, though, so it's a temporary situation. And I think in the long run, they're doing a great job of what we said they'd set out to do, shutting down the Telenos.
I want to point out something for a moment here, TJ. We have magic damage coming out from Zil. We have magic damage coming out from Liliana and Roxy, and we have magic damage coming out from Skye. There's going to have to be a lot of magic defense coming out from x6tence if they want to stay alive.
A full build towards Braps. This Abyssal Dragon will help with that build, as it's the second picked up by x6tence. We criticized them during game one for getting a lot of monsters, a lot of kills, not building a gold lead. Same's happening here.
Same exact situation, two Abyssal Dragons and a kill and First Blood, and they're losing the gold situation right now as Random continuing to just be annoying.
I think he just charged forward to cut that wave, Random up top. I think he just charged forward underneath the tower in order to do that. Now they're trying to punish. The second kill onto him, perhaps available as Bamboo roams up again. The Exuberance will secure the kill. And they keep shutting down top lane, and he still keeps winning it.
You know, know the saddest part about that for me, TJ? Okay.
Royds in a lot of trouble. We'll get back behind tower. Mowgli opened up strong, but it was x6tence again to save him.
Yeah, they're able to get away there, which means they don't lose anyone. And they start to build this lead at least a tiny bit.
That Chognar really working out.
I will not concede that point.
Speaking to an admitted elephant hater, that Chognar is paying off.
Paying off by not dying, sure. I think Toro could do that just as fine.
x6tence scared back behind tower. They are losing that bottom lane. He'll have to recall as well.
Well, Qlash keeping it close despite the fact they're losing basically everything on the field so far. Bamboo picking up Soaring Aura. That is an item I haven't seen in quite a while now.
Yeah, I like the Soaring Aura coming through on the Jhinarsh because, of course, the Soaring Aura provides AoE damage reduction against magic damage.
Right.
So you can jump into the middle of the fight with these Death Ball compositions and just do a little bit to help everyone.
And by the way, Klimeris does do a little bit of magic damage when you use your auto attack after...
And x6tence just...
It's a support. Okay, I'm not going to give it to x6tence. Come
the
on.
Elephant does the elephant do magic damage.
A tiny, tiny bit. He has zero magic damage. Oh, never mind.
It's doing a lot of magic damage, Daniel, but he does get shut down. Redemption comes through. The full tornado lands. Mowgli was the first to fall. And Sky's chasing 1v2 into Royds. He'll get chased back eventually, but only because there aren't any more targets to shoot up top. Random's winning his lane as well. Blue Dragon forced to Metamorphosis just to get wave clear through. He'll do that now and challenge Random a little bit more. He can't hold this, and because of that, he can't clear this wave. Random. This could actually go very wrong. Blue Triton cannot keep this up, but also Random doesn't have the tower damage.
Qlash has completely flipped this over the course of just about a minute there, going extremely aggressive against them, and x6tence are having a tough time. I don't know if they're going to be able to hold on if this continues.
They flipped a switch just like last game, and the Abyssal Dragon goes over to them as well, putting Qlash back in the gold lead.
Yeah, and this is, again, the biggest lead for either team. Qlash starting to pick that up. They decided to flip the switch a little bit earlier this time. And now Telenos is starting to come online. Already has that Clavis Sancti. Looks like she's going for that Bow of Slaughter as well.
It's the weirdest thing, because it's not like a Demmer switch. They're not coming online slowly. They just go, oh, yeah, we're going to play aggressive.
It's like, oh, I found the switch. It's right here. Here we go. Let's just, Telenos feeling pretty good right now.
Does pay off as the Telenos manages to get farmed up, do a ton of damage in that one fight they took. Now, the victory in the top lane finally begins to add up as Sky should be able to take out the tower. Triton scares him back. The rest of x6tence are here. This could get dangerous as Mowgli stalls up the fight with the Dark Dominion. I think he might have just saved his team.
I love this play from Qlash. They're running x6tence around. All they care about is towers. And once the death ball comes, they say, no thanks. We'll talk to you later.
And they swap Random down to the bot lane, where it continues to push wave and continues to steal jungle.
Right, I think even though Random did a good job pushing down the tower, what they want to do is have Sky and Mowgli rotate over, take down towers, and then just have Random on an island so that if anyone wants to deal with him, they have to send multiple members to the opposite side of the map.
It's okay if Random dies because he takes so much effort to kill that it's just not worth it.
Yeah, well, if Royce can take him out by himself, it's a little bit better, but he cannot. This can take multiple members, which means the Dark Slayer.
Yeah, the second that triple quadruple engage comes through onto Random, Qlash say, oh, okay, we'll take Dark Slayer then.
That is great map awareness, by the way. They knew exactly. They had everyone on the map taken account of, and they went directly for the Dark Slayer even before they saw Random getting engaged upon. They were already on top of it.
Redemption will be in trouble as well. x6tence are trying to answer back with what little they can. Control near the soon-to-be-enraged Abyssal Dragon, maybe hoping that'll put them back in the game.
Seems like x6tence are trying to get back some sort of advantage when I don't think they have the opportunity to, but Bamboo!
That's a heavy engage with the Exuberance. He's already gone. Metamorphosis does find a kill. Sky's the first to fall, but they've lost Klimeris. They've lost Bamboo. x6tence need to run as Mowgli and Red now look for the counterattack. They've got Zephyr coming in on the flank as well, and Royds is annihilated by the Foxtrot. Qlash have won yet another fight, and x6tence overextension may hurt them a great deal.
Look at Random, just under the tower, gives no care at all over there. And oh my goodness, they are pushing in. They are not afraid of the x6tence team.
Blue Tritons forced to play behind tower number two as they're losing their tier ones now all the way across the map.
I just love Zepta literally running circles around Royds in that past fight, just taking him out with ease, and now another tower goes down.
Trixen needs to leap to safety. He doesn't have his metamorphosis. He does have Klebaers, but not for long, as the wind shift, wind blade combo from Redemption will find the kill onto the opposing jungler.
Redemption has been playing so well on this Zil so far. You saw it earlier with the tornado to cancel out the exuberance, just making x6tence look like a joke at the moment.
Royds is desperately trying to kill this dragon, and he's got Chikatin now to do it, and the dragon slaying duo will get rid of it, but it's random again. He's okay being a little bit of a dragon on his own, a big flying, flapping distraction, while the rest of the team focuses in on the mid tower, and they take it for free. Trixen does spend the metamorphosis, but it will not be enough.
And this is a devastating goal lead at the moment, but Bamboo
will jump in. Bamboo trying to find the damage yet again. The exuberance does not pay off. Chikatin's gone as well, and x6tence are forced back behind their high grounds.
It got random, but at what cost, DJ? Look how much effort it took to take down one hero, and in exchange, they lose to and have to retreat.
And every single time it feels this way, it's random to fall. Sure, his KD, if you look at it in isolation, is actually really bad, but that's okay, because the rest of the team is making up for it. The rest of the team is using him being an isolating distraction to do things like this. This Abyssal Dragon, though, maybe a bit much.
We'll see if they can get stolen by
Lemares. Leaps in, zones the back. They stole up the fight zone.
No.
Absolutely obliterate the x6tence players.
Slapped down by a Qlash. He says, what are you even doing here?
I loved how they played that. They backed up, stalled out the fight, stopped damaging the dragon just so they could focus down the two players.
Just great mechanics there coming out from Qlash, knowing exactly what x6tence was doing and playing them like they know that they're better.
And they certainly look better right now, as for the second game in a row, they approach the core.
Looks like they're trying to go for these top towers here. Sky going to be doing a lot of damage, not focusing the tower, though. I would like to see him go for that a little bit sooner.
Chikatin will zone out. Redemption, are you sure? He's got the essence of the wind for the shielding. They'll take down the tower. It's narrow, but he'll live.
Don't always see a Zil tanking the tower, but I guess what works works.
Bamboo dives Sky. That could be a big opening, but he spends the bow of Slaughter and just wins out the trade. Now Blue tries to dive desperately, trying to hold the fine. He does have a good metamorphosis,
Sky.
But he's burned down.
Sky
is doing so much damage. He's got another fight to his name, and they've got this core under threat and in the bag as Qlash push all the way forward. Royds chased back in his face, and it will be the game back in Qlash's favor.
Don't do it to them, Qlash. Another flip of the switch and another victory for Qlash. What a beautiful turn of events in that mid game. And once Sky and Red and Random came alive, it was all.